for tuning in. Welcome to Disassociation Nation, live on the Freedom Phalanx Radio Network. I'm your host, Jeff Nizio, but you can call me Niz. I'm joined this evening by my co-host, PGC, Mr. Paul Gordon Collier. How you doing tonight, Paul?
I'm doing great. I'm doing super. I'm doing fantastic. We've got some exciting stuff lined up for this show. It's going to be the best show ever.
That's right. A little later in the show, we'll be joined by our guest for tonight, Cal Molinay.
It's Cal, don't call me Molinette Molinay. That's the official full term, right? You know what?
We're going to be talking about anarcho-capitalism and a stateless society. Colin Lines.
Temporary lapse of reason there, but I'm recovered.
You recovered quickly.
I do.
That's all that matters. That's all that matters. Call-in lines are open from the top of the show. The number to call is 218-895-3818. Or you can reach us while we're live via Skype. Feel free to hit us up at FPRN Radio Live. I have to make sure to say that Skype is only available while we're live, right, Mr. Producer?
That's a good point.
That is correct.
That's right. Otherwise, people listening to the rebroadcast are hitting up Mr. P at all kinds of weird hours.
Hey, where's the show? I'm on Skype, and I don't see the show.
Maybe you shouldn't watch the show. No, seriously.
So, PGC, why don't you tell the audience about that super-duper special license
that we have? You like that right there? You see that right there? You see that? That's a button. That's a Freedom Fiends button. You can go to freedomfiends.com, but this button means something. This is a BIPCOT.org license show. That means that you can take this show and you can do anything you want with it within reason. Okay, not really within reason, but I'm begging you within reason. And except unless, of course, you're with the government or you're propagandizing with the government. I want to add that part. I'm going to have to consult with the Freedom Fiends Council. I don't think they have one, but I will. And they should add that. If you're proselytizing the government, maybe you shouldn't use this show. What do you think? Is that too much? Too soon?
That sounds fair. If you're colluding,
with then, the enemy, man.
That's right. You're free to use our material as long as you...
Can I add this real quick? Just because I know that something's going to happen on this show. Everything about this show is a parody. A relation to any person, living or dead, is purely coincidental. This is meant for purely parody services purposes, not therapeutic or medicinal purposes. If you take our advice and actually run with it and end up blowing up something, it's not our fault. So we're covered. I know, Niz, well, you're going to say something that after a while it's going to be like, oh, dude, I'm so glad you said that.
Yeah. Because that's usually how it goes, you know? After the show, you're like, oh, God.
Oh, man, did I say that?
What did I do? did I really say that? So you're free to use our material so long as your name isn't that dastardly supergiant, that hulking titan of tyranny, Uncle Sam.
Good, man.
Then you're good. You're all good.
So do we want to do the do you have more particulars that you have to announce there that I might
call? No, that's pretty much it.
Should we do the 2 minute WWE introduction to Mr. Molinay?
Sure, why not? Let's go. We could bring him in for this news article here that I have.
Okay, so go ahead, Mr. Producer Man, and play a lock one.
Hello, my name is Cal Molinay from Richmond, Virginia, and I'm an anarchist.
We interrupt our program with a special bulletin.
So I'm just going to ask you three simple questions. Okay. Very briefly discuss how government is moral, and then ask what your thoughts and comments are. Sounds cool? All right.
First question. Very easy. All right, first question. In your day-to-day lives, do you use violence to solve your personal problems?
Probably.
All right.
Like to slap her.
All right. So violence would be defined as placing a person in an involuntary position without their consent or choice, right? I rape, murder, theft, and assault.
Oh, no. Right? Okay.
This is how government then is immoral. This organization that calls itself the government then only knows how to solve problems through one way, a singular way, and that's through the threat of and use of violence to solve any problems versus the plurality of nonviolent solutions that you and I already share.
Normally, I'm super for violence. But if not as nice as you might think sometimes.
Right? Yeah?
First question. In your day-to-day life, do you use violence to solve your personal problems?
No.
Oh, you can have playful, you know, things with each other, like with siblings, right? Boxing's consensual, right?
Right.
Let's agree to the rules. No ear biting, mind ticing, nothing below the waist, right?
Yeah.
And then we can box, right? That's consensual. I mean, you're a kid. I mean, that's bad parenting. That's where you're learning it from.
Yeah, I'm learning from my mom. And just she has all these stupid...
But what happens to her dad?
Exactly.
Right? That's a horrible upbringing that you're being there.
I don't have a dad.
I'm sorry to bring that up.
I don't have a dad.
All right, you were born, it was a natural conception.
Yes.
Immaculate conception,
I'm like Jesus.
Yes, you are, absolutely,
Yes.
They brought mirth and chicken fingers and...
mirth and chicken fingers.
Oh, that was great, right? And some two gold, it was great.
Second question. With the exception of self-defense of yourself and other people, would you consider it wrong and immoral to initiate that violence?
I think so, yeah.
Right?
So what do you think about... Well, so what is government? Government has a monopoly on the services you and I want, right? I want liquor, ABC has a monopoly on that. I want to deliver mail, the post office has a monopoly on first-class mail, right? So that's what government is, a monopoly on the services you and I want, but we don't have the economic freedom to cancel or unsubscribe as you can from a real business. Like a couple years ago, Netflix tried to increase the price overnight, people were like, fuck that, cancel, you know, unsubscribe, go to Hulu. Yeah, you can go anywhere else, right?
Yeah.
But when government does has a monopoly, you can't go anywhere else because it's also illegal for you to compete entrepreneurially, right?
Oh, yes.
So what do you think about abolishing these monopolies, abolishing government altogether?
Exactly. I think to a certain extent, we need the government for roads and shit.
Yeah. All right, so the second question would be, with the exception of self-defense of yourself and others, would you consider it then wrong and immoral to initiate that force?
And then the last question would be, would you also consider it wrong and immoral to violently force your ideas onto other people?
Yeah.
All right, perfect then.
That's also a monopoly.
That's also a monopoly. But I actually went for a road construction. Well, I actually worked for a road construction company.
So businesses will build roads.
Businesses can build roads, but
government doesn't build them. You
exactly.
just said it.
We work for them.
We interrupt them.
So now, ladies and gentlemen, we introduce the world's greatest. I'm going to call you what did you call him, Niz? It was so awesome. You ruined my shtick. I can't remember. What was it? What did you call him?
I don't remember now. I have a memory like
the Encap Evangelist.
There you go.
Molinette.
You like that? No, that's great.
I just said, you know what? I'm just going to get this over with early and just move on. But Cal, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thank you so much for letting me be a part of this wonderful discussion experience here with you guys.
Probably the best show that you've ever been on.
You guys are on a really good network there.
Yeah. We love this network. We made it everything it was. Well, Niz, right, Mr. Producer?
No comment.
I'm a little worried about that. So Niz, you got stuff. I've got stuff. This week, the Pew Research Center, it was actually Wednesday, December 9th, they released a report that indicates that contrary to popular political promises, the middle class is not just shrinking, but rather vanishing. Now, there was an article in the LA Times, I believe it was by Don Lee, and I don't believe it was by Don Lee. And let me get some of the painfully obvious stuff out of the way here. Analysts, policymakers regard this shift as worrisome, obviously, for economic and social stability. Median income voters, particularly non-college educated men, are also at the core of Trump's surge in the polls there for the Republican presidential nomination. They said that his supporters sense that their once secure middle class standing is in danger of slipping, and that appears to be fueling much of the anger against government and against immigrant groups. You know, they took our jobs.
You know what? They took our jobs. They took our freedoms. You know what we need to do? We need to give them more power.
And, Mr. Producer, if you could, I have that image there, A1 in the folder. If you could pop that up on the screen there. This graph from the Pew Research Center shows that in 1971, the middle class accounted for 61% of the population, which now, after all the big government growth in the name of saving a doomed and shrinking middle class,
lifting everybody up,
is down to just under 50% of the population. So a 10%, 11% drop. So according to Pew, what they consider middle class would be a family of three with a total annual income that ranges anywhere between $42,000 and $126,000 a year. And for years now, the one of the excuses for government expansion and the erosion of liberty is that one of the excuses that we've heard more than it's for the kids and terrorism is this resurrection of the middle class. But it's not happening. It's the opposite that's happening. What we're seeing is that the more burdensome government becomes, the worse off the people are. I mean, I don't know where anyone ever got the idea that government was some benevolent, caring overseer of humanity in the first place. Oh, wait. I do know where they got that idea. From the government.
Schools, too.
So the question I have for you both is, do you think that it's possible that maybe this is happening by design? Because the more you widen that appearance of the us, the poor, against them, the rich diatribe, the easier people begin to be manipulated, the easier they are to be duped into this reactionary, oh, save us, big government, kind of line of thinking. If we only dig the hole deeper, we'll get a better glimpse of the sun.
Go ahead, Cal. You're the guest. You go first.
Well, I guess the depreciation of fiat currency aside, there was also a recent report that was published recently about the reason why you are over 70% poorer is because of all these government restrictions on businesses, which, of course, accrue a lot more added costs to run a business, money in your purse as an employee, and of course, increasing cost of consumer goods. Right, so the access in that market to propel yourself is one of the reasons of areas of why you don't really have that access anymore because of all these restrictions. Right, it's the same argument against minimum wage. It's very difficult when you have all these added costs for them to hire new people, to lower prices, to expand, to grow. And these costs inevitably have to be sustained somehow otherwise. You talk about the middle class. Yeah, you're also talking about small business owners. You're talking about people trying to enter that market and provide a service, and they find it increasingly very difficult to do it. And now many of them will come across the question that it's not even worth it anymore to take that risk with their own capital to delve in there. The government is just going to take a lot of it, and there's no much guarantee when most of your profit is taken away, stolen from you by government. But I guess in your question about class warfare, yeah, I mean that's your Marxist talk there, right? That's the stuff that they peddle around in your academic arenas, universities. When they talk about alternative thought and these academic lying centers. They know the students there will like to see some kind of alternative, and the way that they can guide that alternative thought is to just show them Marxism. Because at least in Marxism, you're still thinking government. At least in Marxism, you're still advocating for government. They don't care, even if it leads to communism. They only care that you still want a political ruler, you still want government, and that's the direction that it'll go. So this area of maybe where is it coming from seems to come from these academic centers. Same thing with where is this idea of the invisible knapsack or check your privilege stuff coming from? It's coming from the academic arena. That's they're pushing this stuff onto these people who will become your middleman, your managers, the people who will be in the upper echelons of the business world, and spreads out and just kind of continues to destroy and continues to divide.
And on another note, one of the folks in our chat room pointed out, hello, welfare state. The more impoverished, the more people that rely on the state. And that's exactly what's happening here. You have, the government is really good at multitasking. So they have managed to do a number of things in nudging us off of our middle class standing. And middle class standing gives us the freedom to make more choices that are not dependent on a government condition to actually make that choice. So on one hand, they get us all moving off of the ability to take care of ourselves. And on the other hand, they create even now we have this, you got a shrinking middle class that is like, dude, I'm willing to accept anything at this point. Just just let me keep my stuff and my flag. If I can keep my stuff and my flag, I will let you take my wife out once a week. Whatever it takes to give me my freedom. And his freedom is a very small freedom. This freedom is defined by his stuff and by his flag and about feeling good and feeling protected. It's not about having, like Cal and Niz, like for folks like us, because we're awesome. Let's not lie about that. We need a lot more freedom and liberty than a lot of other people because we are driven to have an impact on the world beyond just, you know, am I going to eat a piece of pizza tomorrow and being able to play Minecraft.
Coke or Pepsi, the Eagles or the right. Steelers. I mean, there's more to it than just that. Yeah.
Right.
And you know, it becomes a positive feedback loop where the greater this this perceived divide becomes, the easier it is to get people to go along. So the more people that you have that are leaving the middle class and starting to become part of the underclass, those people become much, much easier to manipulate and to prod and push into doing the things that the government wants them to do, which is to perpetuate larger and larger government. I mean, when you see your neighbor's house getting foreclosed on, and you know, it starts to get real easy when you start to feel the heat to say, hey, listen, I'm from the government and I'm here to help. You're willing to say, well, I'll do whatever you want me to do. Just save me.
Well, we had Ronald Reagan who made fun of that. And I mean, he was a champion of no government, right? am I getting laughed?
I think you're being facetious.
Some facetiousness leveled in there. Yeah. But I mean, he did say all the right things. Isn't that enough? Cal, isn't that enough? I mean, he said,
we're here from the government. We're here to help.
And now you have our Bernie Sanders saying the quote right thing, right? Trying to create this area divide of the people, the haves and have-nots, without realizing that, you know, they're really, it's a blur, you know, the distinction, as they will say, between class and the underclass or the poor class. And it's easy to forget that, you know, the poor are here in the United States are like among the richest in comparison to other tax farms around the world. The poor here have refrigerators, computers. Majority of them have electric stoves, microwaves, air conditioning, video recorders, cell phones. 7 billion people on this planet, 6 billion of them have cell phones. Not as poor when you take account the poor and other tax farms. I just think it's another form of a distraction, another way to rail against, you know, what's left of capitalism, whatever that is. And of course, that's the way the government has always set it up to be, you know, that we're here to protect you from these business owners. We're here to protect you from these monsters of corporations that they created in the first place, right? So it's the boogeyman. It's the, you know, the question people say, well, look at all the houses that Bill Gates has, you know, it's just trying to distract you and looking at the real common denominator for all these social ills and problems is the state. So there is a lot of divide that's manufactured and purposely done to create that division.
Well, it really is.
I'm sorry. Go ahead, Niz.
No, well, I'm just want to say it really is a false dichotomy. I mean, it's an illusion. It's being framed as it's us the poor against them the rich when that's not the real struggle. The actual struggle is between us the people and them the ruling class.
Well, I just want to say that us the people is not as broad as you think it is. I mean, I was thinking about this the other day, and actually I had one of those moments of white terror. And I mean, I don't mean white, I mean white like you turn white kind of terror. Where I realized that I am surrounded by, I don't know, 250 or more million people who want to lobby the government to force me to act and behave and purchase and think a certain way. And they're on the left and they're on the right. Those folks are every bit as part of the government class as the actual people who run the government, because they're the ones who, out of their fear to be protected, You know, whether it's a Christian who wants to use the state to make sure that Christianity survives, or whether it's Bernie Sanders who wants to make sure that everybody gets their fair share, whatever it is, or whether it's the flag waving neocon who, at the end of the day, the flag waving neocon, they just want to be the best. They just want to be number one. They believe that America needs to be the king cobra of the entire world and crush and kill in order for them to be able to play Xbox the next morning. So when we say government class, I'm not sure that there aren't a whole lot more people in that government class than we're calling right now.
For the same, I entirely agree. There's no such thing as a class war. It's a political war. It's political party war, gang warfare that has everyone cut up. Same thing with when people talk about racial hatred divide. Where is that coming from? From the government. And that's also a term that was coined by communists. In order to create further divide. To further sow division among people and have them attacking each other, right? That's how you control a tax farm. If you're the prison wardens, you want the prisoners, the slaves, to focus on each other and keep each other in check instead of worrying about the ones who are guarding the cages. We don't want them uniting and taking and abolishing the prisons and cages that surround them.
No, I'm going to interrupt you here because we got about 7 minutes or so left in this segment, Niz. Mm-hmm. You think we should move on to introduce Cal more fully to the audience?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Because there's only 3 people that have ever heard of you, Cal, and they all live in my basement. It's weird. So we're trying to expand that, But don't be afraid. No, I got one person that's heard of me, and that's my mother. So,
My first Facebook friend was my mother. So, yeah, there we go. That's where the support comes from.
You know what? That would be a great name for a band. My first Facebook friend was my mom. Seriously. Would you go and listen to that band? I would totally listen to that band. So Cal, Niz, do you want to... We actually didn't talk about this pre-show. Who's going to walk us through this?
No, that's okay. You can go ahead. You can go ahead, Paul.
So, Cal, I approached you. I've been watching your videos, and I really love what you do, the activism, the type of activism that you do. And we'll get to that more on the B thing. And I want to do the obligatory, Cliff Notes version. I know everybody does it. I still think it serves a real purpose because you never know who's listening to your show that doesn't know anything about what true liberty is. In really brief, how did you come to true liberty? Cliff Notes version.
Well, Cliff Notes version. Well, I guess I grew up believing that everyone around me were liars and cowards. Didn't really grow up with my parents, so a lot of no parental figures there. Bad experience with the cops when I was 7, when I came here to the U.S. So already a sour taste for police extortionists and a deep hatred for them. And so I just kind of grew up with a disgust with authority figures, people who I saw as just tall children running around raising smaller children. And so I just saw...
So you had no veneer then? Ever. You didn't, like most of us have had that veneer. I remember when I was 9 years old, my grandfather died. It was like, holy crap, stuff changes, stuff happens. And I was like, I'm 9 years old. It took me till my 30s to fully take off the scale, so to speak. So you're saying from early on, that veneer was gone.
Right. And I would think it was a good thing. I mean, it's not a good thing to not have parents, around you and to properly raise you. But the lack of parenting was a good thing, I would say, in that I didn't adopt, their rituals of bad rituals, I would say, the kind of lies that will come with that. By the time I started knowing my father, it was like 7 or 8, and it's already too late, to try to trick me and lie to me and to conform me and to obeying. So I would say that's kind of where I started. I had a lot of great interest in anti-authoritative movements from there.
So you've been there the whole time then, basically. No, I was looking for some great story. I started off loving flags and tanks and nothing like that. So no. Now I'm a little confused at what you do. I know what you do as far as your street outreach. Well, first off, what do you term what you do as far as those street videos?
I would say I call them spreading anarchy, right? Anarchy being synonymous with freedom. Anarchy being the exact opposite of the state, whereas the state can only conduct its affairs through coercion and violating consent. Therefore, the opposite of that would be anarchy. Anarchy is the essence of anarchy is consent. So it's an advocation for a free society based on consent versus the coercive one that's from top down pointed guns at everyone to obey, to submit. And that is their government.
Now, I just want to let you know that one of your three fans is in the chat room. And I apologize. They have actually been in my basement since 1968. Dude, I'm so sorry. So what another thing that I notice about you that I want to know more about is you call it Liberate RVA, and this is Richmond, Virginia. You have a real local focus, and I've only crossed over. I've been crossed over, that's my terminology, for about a year. So, you know, I'm still learning where everything is. So I may very well be wrong in this, but I don't see, at least at a more visible level, I don't see a lot of folks so focused on the local level like you are. What is your strategy for how you're approaching spreading anarchy in Richmond, Virginia?
It's the same strategy you can find anywhere else, right? Change doesn't start in a White House in D.C. It doesn't start in countries you've never been to. It starts with yourself. At a home, within your own interpersonal relationships. And so for me, it started with that. For me, it started with my friends.
No, what I mean is, what do you hope, because you're not calling yourself Liberate RVA by accident. You had a specific reason why.
Right. So the specific reason came from looking through many, many groups and organizations and being let down time and time after time, and lack of measure of success in those organizations. And eventually the last one was Occupy, and that was it. After a week, I couldn't tolerate it any longer. The message was not consistent, and I left. And about a year later, after having these discussions with my friends, we launched the opposite, Liberate RVA. You already are occupied by terrorism. We're already occupied by more violence. We're already occupied by all of this evil. There's no need to further occupy with any more of that crap. So the opposite of that will be to liberate our community from the idea that violence would set us free. And not just state violence, you know, you have to apply it consistently. It's also against the violence we do to each other. And most importantly, the violence is on the children. You know, spanking children, hitting them, assaulting them, only teaches them that violence is a way to solve problems in this world when they grow up. And so finally, just to create an organization that is consistent with its foundations, that is consistent with its principles, with its values, with no exceptions. When you create exceptions within organizations, you allow anybody to come in and take the message and the meaning of the word and bastardize it. Now you're able to take it further away from its original intent. And that's happened throughout history with a lot of, you know, good ideas.
We got the music in, and we'll be asking questions here that hopefully you get more of that awesome stuff out. So we'll see you on the other side of the break on the B block. We will introduce you to Gov Burgers, and we're going to talk more with Cal Molinay. See, I said Molinay. I'm a boss.
You got it.
Welcome back to the B block on Disassociation Nation. Niz, you have some particulars to share that I never remember this, so I rely on you because you're smarter than me.
Oh, I wouldn't necessarily say I'm smarter than you, but I have them written down in front of me.
Well, then you're smarter than me because I didn't write them down. So there.
Yeah, sure. Absolutely. Call lines are open. They're open from the top of the show to the bottom. Number to call is, as always, 218-895-3818 in case that was too fast. That's 218-895-3818. You can also reach us at niz@disassociationnation.com if you want to send us an email. And I think that's about it.
And while we were on break, and I know Cal is going to deny this, but that's cool. While we were on break, Cal said, no, I like the way you said Molinet. Just Molinet, not Cal Molinay. Not Molinay, not Cal, Molinet. I'm gonna have my name changed to Molinet. That's what Cal said. Now I know he's going to deny it. We all know that. But, you know, when you see it happen a year from now, everybody will be like, dude.
But you did proposition me, so, you know. So take me out on a date first, and you can call me whatever you want, right?
Well, okay. where would you like to go?
I like Silver Diners is pretty good, you know. But we could resume your proposition after the show.
Hey, can I conceal carry in Richmond?
Yeah, absolutely.
Otherwise, I can't go.
Perfectly safe here, absolutely.
Okay, good, because then I'm all about Richmond. So what we're going to do here, I've actually devised a little script. Usually during the B block, we'll be doing either, you know, sometimes Frico will be with us. Cal Frico is, he's waiting for the zombie apocalypse, and he is pledging that he will defeat the zombies and he will create a world filled with nothing but liberty. And we get his little ham radio signals every once in a while. People say he's cray-cray, but I take what he says to be totally true. But this week, instead, we're going to – the segment we're going to call Freedom Czar, and we're going to set it up after we hear the awesome skit, which is probably the best skit. I don't know if you guys know that I've all night long so far I've been channeling my inner Donald Trump. You know, this is the greatest show ever. I'm, you know, people don't know this about me, but I'm, and people wouldn't guess it, but I'm really good at military. I am the best at military. We will have the best military ever. Our military is going to be so good.
Paul called me this morning and he said, you know what? I have a great idea for the show. We need to get a registry together.
Yeah.
And they need to be assigned a number and have it tattooed on our foreheads.
Good idea. Good idea. So let's go ahead.
Right idea.
And we'll do. We're going to be introducing you to the world of Gov Burgers, and then when we come back on the other side, we've got some penetrating questions for Cal, especially where Cal was in the summer of '92. You guys are going to want to hold on for that one. So go ahead, Mr. Producer, play that clip. Play that clip.
Beaten and broken, our liberty dimmed, the enemy advances. He always wins. He has all the answers. We're crushed by his power. We fall to our knees in this darkest hour. Not so fast. Freedom Czar is here from FreedomCzar.com. We'll show you how to win against the enemy of liberty from without and within. And now, this week's Freedom Czar Report.
Welcome to Gov Burgers, home of the Gov Burger. Can I take your order?
Yeah, I'd like to buy a burger.
What would you like with that burger?
Just a small Coke and fries.
But only fries? Don't you want cheese nuggets with the Gov Burgers?
Well, I don't really want cheese nuggets with my Gov Burger, no.
Do you hate people?
What?
Do you hate people? You hear me? Do you hate people?
No.
Then why won't you order the cheese nuggets?
Well, I'm not hungry for cheese nuggets.
Do you know how many people have jobs because of cheese nuggets?
No.
Well, we don't either, but I'm sure it's a lot. And if you don't buy cheese nuggets, some of those people, if not all of them, will lose their jobs. They won't be able to get Christmas gifts for their kids this year. They'll probably end up homeless and die, overdosed on drugs because you wouldn't buy cheese nuggets. Does that make you feel good, hater?
If they lose their jobs, couldn't they just find a new job?
Well, that is besides the point. Hater! Now, if you really want a burger, you're gonna have to buy cheese nuggets too.
Well, maybe I'll just go somewhere else where I can buy a burger without the cheese nuggets.
Oh, no, you don't! What? Now you hate your country too?
No, I don't see how.
Well, if you don't like this country, you can just leave.
Well, okay. No, not so fast.
Doesn't work like that.
You just said I could leave.
I was being rhetorical. You have to stay.
I choose not to stay.
Oh, you'll stay. Or do you hate the burger police too?
There's a burger police?
Yeah. You got a problem with that? We want to have to put you on the no burger list. You don't want to be on the no burger list, would you?
Look, okay, this isn't worth the hassle. And I'm hungry. I'll take the cheese nuggets.
Great. That'd be $245 for a burger? One burger? Do you hate the poor?
I don't particularly.
Then what is your problem paying $245 for your burger? People are starving. For every burger you buy, three more get burgers.
Three more poor people?
Oh, don't be unrealistic. I get a burger for having to wait on your complaining terroristic ass. And of course, Daddy Gov gets his burger for having to allow you to come into the store that he pays for.
Listen, I put up with the freaking cheese nuggets, but this is over the top. I'm just gonna go.
Oh, you're not going anywhere. You will buy this burger, and you will like it. I don't want to see you blog about it or tweet your negative experiences. Definitely don't want to see your whiny posts on Facebook. Just give us a $245 and take your burger like a good patriot. You do love freedom, don't you?
Freedom?
Yeah, freedom. Now give us your money or else.
I don't really have a choice now, do I?
Well, thank you for doing business with us. Here you go. One freedom burger.
Wait, this burger's got a bite out of it. And it smells like feet.
We're sorry, sir. You can vote for a new Gov Burger manager next year if you don't like the current one.
I don't want to vote. I want to eat a burger that doesn't smell like feet.
Well, if you won't vote, you can't complain.
And the moral of this story? Without government, who will make freedom burgers?
And that's the question I think that we all have on our mind today. Without government, who will make our freedom burgers? Cal, when you listened to this, did you not see the error in your ways and realize that we do need government for freedom burgers?
All you have to do is vote harder.
Get me kind of hungry talking about
Well, then that's all it takes, just a little bit of hunger, and you just accept the government. That's good. See, I'm evangelizing the government right now. That's what I'm doing. Holy crap. I have to take this .org license off. So, Niz, we have questions for Cal. First of all, I'm not allowed. My lawyers consulted me. While we were in break, and they said, I cannot ask Cal about the summer of 92. So, Cal, we're going to avoid that whole incident, all right?
That's not a difficult question. I was, I know exactly where I was.
Oh, do you? Yeah. Oh, do you?
I was at Deerfer Run Elementary School learning English and trying to separate, trying to figure out the language here.
So where were you imported from? Can I say imported from? Were you imported from somewhere?
No, I was born on a U.S. military base.
Yeah.
So I guess you could say, but of course, you know, I'm a baby, I'm a kid. So, you know, and then along the way, parents divorce and you go all over the place. And then eventually, go ahead.
So when you say you were in elementary school learning English, you mean like. What grade were you in?
That was the first school I went to. It wasn't. I had a lot of catching up to do since I was gone for quite a long time. So I had to go to a different school with other foreign kids and try to understand and learn English. And then after that, I was finally put into regular public indoctrination camps where I had to do, you know, catch up with all the grades and everything.
Can I do a microaggression now? Dying to do
it. You speak English well.
Isn't that a microaggression?
Yeah. You're very articulate.
Thank you. You're very articulate. That's very. You almost speak like an English speaker. How about that?
You play the American part out really well there with Richard Lust for hamburgers and all.
Thank you very much. I'm actually getting in. I'm slowly moving towards getting in character because you guys are going to meet Frank the Flag in the C block and. Yeah, a little bit of Frank is coming out. It's you know, it's when you're a method actor, this is what you got to do. So Niz, why don't you start with your question? I really like your questions, actually.
Okay, well, Cal, you know, whenever I talk to people about anarcho-capitalism, the most common response that I get is that it's great in theory, but it could never exist without a society that possesses a perfect morality. My question is, what would the transition from the mess that we have now to an ANCAP society look like? I mean, there are a lot of people who are hopelessly dependent on the state. And you can take a look at what happened in Greece when they cut just some of their government handouts. And we've got a lot more people like that here. I mean, what would happen to those people?
Well, I guess you already have some kind of examples where it does not lead to mass hysteria and mass war, and you have the collapse of USSR. Throughout history, you have a lot of recorded evidence of many empires collapsing and not necessarily going in full broil mayhem. When the collapse of USSR occurred, for example, on the Eastern Bloc of Europe, there is no such thing that occurred there. It's relatively peaceful and the way of seceding from the empire. But of course, they seceded into states themselves because that's all they know. Same thing of with many other areas in life. When the state abolishes, you know, what are they going to redo? They're going to repeat the matrix. That's all they've ever learned. That's all the information that's ever given to them. That's why they go to thousands of hours in public indoctrination camps to teach them repeatedly that a state is what you need, and that's how you can't have life without them. So the transition is relatively peaceful, I would say. Here in Richmond, it's been very relatively peaceful in the way of many people letting go of the idea of that violence will set you free, that politics will set you free, that the political rulers have any investment to care about you, to help you. And so that transition has been remarkably well. In the over 100 ANCAPs now, anarchists here in Richmond that have made that transition, and without any blood feud or anything like that, that was peaceful in that transition to let go of politics, to let go of the idea that you need government. I guess maybe perhaps we're talking about the plan, or is that maybe perhaps your curiosity in how to get to that transition?
Well, just I took that question from a...
It's the big question.
I took that question from a conversation that I had recently where the other party in the conversation was having a difficult time picturing what this transition would look like. And they kept going back to this. I'm sure you've heard it over and over and over again. You know, this total chaos and Mad Max.
Somalia.
The thing you have to remind them is that what you have today is chaos. With the millions and millions of people suffering in these cages, many of them rape cages for victimless crimes. A majority of them are there, and their peaceful people have been kidnapped and are suffering because of victimless crimes. Millions of them. You have more prisoners in those smaller cages in the United States versus any other totalitarian country in the world. Right? There's no respect for private property here. There's no respect for self-ownership here. The United States government itself has murdered tens of millions since World War II. How is that not defined as chaos? What you have around here right now and existing in this place is chaos. This is your post-apocalypse. Especially when there's no obligation, when the Supreme Court has already ruled and many times over versus like in Winnebago versus DeShaney County that the police have no obligation to protect your life, liberty, or property. There exists then when you walk outside your house or even in your house, no such protection. There is the illusion that you are protected.
I am protected.
Yeah, by your delusions. That's perfectly fine.
No. By my Springfield XD9.
Right. The only protection you have is what you bring with you or the...
Yeah, absolutely. That's exactly my point. Your only protection is the protection that you provide for yourself.
Right. That's the reality of the situation. And a lot of people have been deceived and misled into believing otherwise. And that's why we have a lot of people being hurt.
So could I give a Clip Notes version of what you say and you tell me if I'm right? I don't know why you're worried about chaos. Chaos already exists. So if you're cool with this chaos, why would you complain about the chaos that offers liberty?
Right. So a lot of people you're mentioning earlier about Greece, the situation in Greece, and people who are very heavily dependent on it. The message in which you would go out there and talk to people is like, it's the trade-off. It's a trade-off of scraps, table scraps that they push off the table from time to time for the real piece of the sky in the sky, for real freedom, for having real self-ownership, for having real property rights, a title ownership over what is yours, not claimed arbitrarily by thieves and murderers, right? So that's the trade-off.
I hate it when thieves and murderers take my spot. And they're doing it right now. We're a little... We got about 10 minutes left here, and I know we're not going to get to all these questions, and we knew we weren't going to. That's fine, but I want to make sure we get to a couple here. So I'm going to move on here to my question, which is, What Niz is asking, I love his questions. His questions are about, okay, what is the answer to this? And mine is about process, how you approach doing what you're doing. And I'm really interested for people that are listening. I would love to see more cows out there doing what you do. So my question is, what do you hope to accomplish when you engage people in your street interview?
I would say I hold no expectations when I go out there. The only thing I'm presenting, you know, there was a mention earlier about processizing. The only thing I do is just present facts and evidence. Right? Facts and evidence just show that this argument against the state aligns with your moral values when it's revealed in that conversation. That you yourself find it immoral and wrong to initiate force, but what does government do anything but initiate force all the time? So I guess, well, not so much what I hope and what I have already accomplished, what we will accomplish here with many other now other champions of liberty is to finally have a real free society based on consent.
But you're going one person at a time, which is I'm all about one person at a time. I believe that's actually we're going to cover in the D block. It's kind of, you know, the emergent model is one person at a time. But when you go out there, I'm assuming that you have something in your head as far as I know you're not going out there thinking, you know, I'm going to go out there and I'm going to bring 15 people to the ANCAP or vision, but there's got to be I understand your overall goal is to spread liberty and to see liberty everywhere, but there's got to be a more localized goal in what you do. The goal that's targeting the person you're talking to, as well as the person who's seeing your videos.
All right. So yeah, of course. So the reasons why the videos are done is so that other people can see how the arguments are presented, right? There's a lot of lies, there's a lot of misconceptions in terms of government. Government has misled everyone since its inception, especially if you go to the public indoctrination camps. So I record them to show how you can engage these conversations. I engage it so that way eventually we can transition to that free society away from government. So I'm just going out there finding fellow champion liberty that already uphold these moral principles. I'm just presenting the misinformation and showing them areas in which they've been lied to and have been misled, just as I and most other people. So I guess that's my intention towards that, just making new friends, you know, finding out that these are would-be anarchists around us. The localization of, go ahead.
So it's actually a large part, actually, in the course of your interviewing, you're finding like-minded folks so you can build. Are you an agorist or agorist, however you pronounce it?
Yeah, you could say agorist. Yeah.
Okay, so you're probably finding folks that will build into that, and you guys can actually build reliance among liberty-minded folks.
Right, we're building a real community that's founded on ethics, that has real consistency with principles and virtues, right? These are people who, once you become part of the tribe, that will never lie to you. They'll never cheat and steal and rob from you. These are people you can trust. These are people who have real absolute respect for private property and self-ownership. That's it, all you need in terms of friends, right? In terms of discovering what are these fundamental areas that we do share. And for the most part, we that's what we share against the initiation of force. But these things are unfound until we have those conversations. And so I go out there to seek those out, to seek out my neighbors and find out that we are friends, that we do share these moral principles against the initiation of force. And we come to find that the tyranny that prevents all that is government, that which we have to abolish together to achieve finally real freedom.
That's a very interesting answer. I actually didn't even think of that aspect. I was totally focused on, okay, you're probably thinking, I know I'm going to run into a certain type set of people, and you know, I have these questions that are designed to flush that out. Where their cognitive dissonance is, and how to at least open the door for them to break down the cognitive dissonance. But your focus on connecting to folks is, I could go on for this question alone. I definitely want to have you back on the show. And Niz, I'm saying this live, so there you go. And maybe I talk to you a little bit more about the standards. I am very driven by standards, very interested in standards, and I understand the double-edged sword of standards. On one hand, if you have too much purity, you end up producing something like the French Revolution. You end up cannibalizing yourself. Actually, it's what's happening in the social justice movement. So I'll love to have, I won't get into that now, but I will definitely love to have you on and find out how you guys are managing some of those conflicting tendencies. Jeff, what's your next question?
I'm actually going to combine two questions in one here because we're getting pressed for time here. But another question that I was asked was the current consequence for murder is death or life in prison, yet murder is still committed at a high rate. Now, if you take away the consequences, would that rate explode? And without a form of police or justice system, who would investigate, regulate, and serve justice for victims? Wouldn't the absence of a state turn every major city into a scene from Escape from L.A. with bands of marauders running the streets? I mean, if you look at New Orleans during the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina, not everybody would want or agree to live by the rules of such a society. If there wasn't a state to enforce the rules, and with no real way such as prison to enforce consequences for breaking any rules, what is there to stop me from saying, hey, nice car, Cal. Boom, bullet to your head. Thanks. It's mine now.
All right, 1 second. What's there to stop me? All right. Quickly writing the laws. All right, so I'll go down through all that.
What's there to stop me? Hold on.
Starting from the entire paragraph that you're trying to say is the thing is that you forget when you're talking about the, you know, murder rates that are committed by people. You know, you're forgetting to neglect that the murder rates are committed at the highest rate by the state. Right, versus private murders, right? So if you're so concerned, if that is your goal, if that's something that you have sincere and genuine concern of the murder of peaceful people, then you have to take a genuine concern of examining the state as being the organization that murders peaceful people at the highest rate versus any other organization that exists, right? So you look at the state and it's kidnapping and murdering anyone who refuses not to obey them, that's what you need to look at. And then for the state, there are no consequences. The rules only apply to you, the tax slip. The rules only apply to you, the prisoners of this tax farm. They do not apply to the prison warden. There are no rules here. The laws the government creates and makes up, these are prison rules. That's all they are. They're not laws of morality. If there were laws of morality, they'd be consistent, right? Theft is theft, murder is murder, regardless of what title or color costume you wear. So if you are genuinely concerned, you would examine that the state itself creates the highest murder rate, and that itself then must be abolished if that is your genuine concern. And under government, you have no such thing as justice. No justice under government, especially under the rules that they make up with the exceptions that allow them to escape that kind. Sometimes they'll throw one another under the bus, but that's only if there's a substantial, huge elephant weight of evidence. But for the most part,
I'm sorry to cut you short here. We got about a minute and a half left.
Okay, I'm going to wrap this up. And then the last thing you're talking about, Katrina, like, look at Katrina. Who was in charge of that? The Federal Emergency Management Agency, right? FEMA, right? So when you rob from people and create an agency that's supposed to provide this service, you eliminate the opportunities in the market for that to have been created, right? That was not a fault of private businesses. That was a fault of government saying, we're going to help you if this occurs, and they fail over and over again. So that's one thing you have to remember. The states do not enforce rules. They enforce prison rules that do not apply to them. And when you talk about who's going to stop you, just look at the areas of Detroit. It takes over an hour for police to respond to 911 calls. Not forgetting to mention that the police have no obligation to protect your life and liberty and property. There exists now private security there, Viper Threat Management Security, that stopped all the hijackings of trucks. And from that service, they're able now to provide to lower income families in those areas that's substantially affordable for them. Right. So who's going to protect each other? People have virtue. People are courageous. You look at the situation at the Bundy Ranch, for example. Who came out there? Voluntary militias to stand down and force government to back off when the subject of property rights reign. The highest moral argument was not something the government could go against.
Wait, that's the music here. So we are going to go ahead and go to the C block on the other side. Mr. Nizman has cop block. And after cop block, we are going to get a little taste of what Cal does when he does some street outreach to to a couple guys right here on FPRN.
Welcome back. In case you just joined us and were wondering what the hell am I listening to, this is Disassociation Nation live on the Freedom Phalanx Radio Network. I'm your host, Niz, and I'm here with my co-host, Mr. PGC. That's Paul Gordon Collier.
Hey, Paolo.
We're joined by Mr. Cal Molinay.
That's me, destroyer of socialism from the House of Anarchy of Richmond, Virginia.
Sounds good.
Humble title. I like it.
The call lines are open. The number to call is 218-895-3818. If you have any questions for Cal or for myself or Paul, give us a call. Love to hear from you. Or you can hit us up on Skype at FPRN Radio Live. So for the cop block this week, I have this this story of Philip Coleman, who was arrested in 2012 after suffering a mental breakdown. He suffered a mental breakdown and attacked his mother. So you can assume that this guy was most likely charged with assault, maybe domestic battery, something like that. But anyway, after months of pressure from the public, the Chicago PD is releasing videos of several incidents of suspected police brutality and abuse, one of which is this case of Philip Coleman, which shows several officers repeatedly tasering Mr. Coleman and then dragging his limp body from the cell. After his arrest, Coleman was taken to the hospital where he's given a drug to make him calm down. According to official reports, it was an allergic reaction to this antipsychotic drug that actually that killed him. But the autopsy on Philip Coleman revealed that he had sustained severe trauma while in police custody. His body was covered from head to toe in bruises and cuts. And now, years later, Chi-Town PD releases this video, and you'll see I have a clip of the news report. You'll see in this, as the video begins in this news report, that it shows Coleman calm, sitting on the bench in the jail cell or bed or whatever it may be. When officers enter and then begin to assault him, and then moments later dragging his body down the hallway. Mr. Producer, if you could please play clip one.
Breaking news, more questionable conduct by Chicago police officers. This video just released by the department. It shows officers using a stun gun on the man inside his jail cell and then dragging that man down a hallway.
Eyewitness News reporter Ben Bradley here with a closer look at the video for us, Ben.
Ron and Kathy, we first reported on this case nearly 3 years ago. Only now, amidst new promises of transparency from City Hall, is the video being released. There's no quarrel about whether officers should have arrested Philip Coleman. He beat up his mom. But tonight, police concede officers crossed the line once Coleman was in custody. More than half a dozen officers are seen entering the cell where Philip Coleman was being held. The box on the screen is for privacy around a toilet. Coleman is seated when officers hit him with several charges from a taser. Moments later comes the part that police brass concede shouldn't have happened. Coleman's limp body is dragged down the corridor, officers pulling him by the wrists. Tonight, Mayor Rahm Emanuel released a statement saying, "I do not see how the manner in which Mr. Coleman was physically treated could possibly be acceptable." This happened 3 years ago after Coleman, who graduated from the University of Chicago, inexplicably attacked his mother in their home. Police say he spit blood on officers when they arrived.
There was just a lot of frustration that was going on. He was in the car. He was pounding on the paddy wagon doors.
Police took Coleman to Roseland Hospital, where doctors gave him a sedative. An autopsy determined he died from an allergic reaction to that drug and not the use of force by police. Nonetheless, their treatment of Coleman while in custody is now being investigated. And 2 years later, for the first time, police admit this incident should have been handled differently, especially considering officers may have been dealing with someone with mental health issues. And documents released by police reveal the officers involved received one-day suspensions. Tonight, the mayor says he doesn't consider the case closed, a sign of a crackdown on police conduct. Back.
So, Mayor Emanuel said that he doesn't see how this could be acceptable. But this is from the guy whose city, according to the media outlet The Guardian, is running a black site. But more on that in just a second here, because I have a video I want to run just in case not everyone is familiar with Gitmo 2.
Rahm the Bomb Emanuel, then just to make sure that everybody knows that Philip Coleman died from his treatment in the hospital and not from his treatment at the precinct, said that while the medical examiner ruled that Mr. Coleman died accidentally as a result of treatment he received in the hospital, it doesn't excuse the way he was treated while he was in custody. Now, it's safe to say that Mayor Emanuel knew about Philip Coleman's death when it happened in 2012. I mean, he was mayor for over 6 months at this point. So why all of a sudden is Rahm Emanuel so intent on having these videos released, including the video from of Philip Coleman, among some others? Don't forget, this is the same Mayor Emanuel that allowed the recently released video of Laquan McDonald to remain in the hands of police for over a year, while he simultaneously offered $5 million in hush money to the victim's family just so that they'd keep quiet about the incident. And he also let this video of Coleman sit on ice since 2012. So what are the odds that the same guy who ran a city with its own secret prison, the black site that I mentioned earlier, that The Guardian did the report on, and that's the same Guardian media outlet that broke the Edward Snowden Operation Prism, NSA spying on everything you do story, that Chicago black site is home and square. What are the odds that the same guy actually gives a rat's ass about some random dude who died in police custody under his watch? I think it's pretty slim. Wouldn't you say? I mean, could it be that, you know, maybe this sudden pseudo-humanity from the state is more of an attempt to placate the angry American citizenry who's starting to get fed up with police brutality and institutional murder? I mean, it's home and square, dude. Come on. You got to do what you got to do to keep your focus away from that shit. And if you're not familiar with home and square, dubbed Gitmo 2 by activists, here's a little piece that The Guardian did on YouTube about what they found. And then after the clip, we'll come back and I'll get your thoughts on this, because I know that sometimes...
Hey, I can give you my thoughts now.
Well, I want to get down. I want to make sure we have enough time to get to the clip and then
it's real
afterwards.
Quick.
Okay.
It sucks.
Sucks.
There you go.
We'll come back then, and we'll get Cal's perspective on this.
Maybe I'll elaborate on it. Sucks.
So, Mr. Producer, could you go ahead and run that clip too, please?
Well, secretive nature of home and square makes it one of the worst experiences I've ever had to deal with. And I can only imagine what's going through the defendants' heads when they're arrested and taken there. Many times, when you go to home and square, you're told the people aren't there. Oh no, we don't have anyone. And the person who's charged with the crime sitting back there thinking, what the hell, where's my family? I know they got a lawyer for me, where's my lawyer? They don't realize that we're outside banging on the door trying to get in, but they're not letting us in.
An ongoing lawsuit filed by The Guardian has revealed that Chicago police brought over 7,000 people to Home and Square since August of 2004. Police allowed lawyers into Home and Square for only 68 of 7,185 arrests.
It's a converted warehouse with inconspicuous doors all over and no front place to even enter. There's no driveway, there's no parking lot, there's nothing. Operating a massive red brick warehouse between two of the most crime-filled areas in the city of Chicago, equipped with floodlights, cameras, razor wire, this near paramilitary wing of the government that we've created, I would say that people live close to it, know what purpose it serves the most. The demographics that surround it speak for themselves.
They kept me outside for about an hour. It was actually longer than an hour. Someone finally came down to get me. And then when I walked up there, there was two prosecutors talking to my client. And when I walked in, they literally looked at me and walked out the other way. When I saw him, I said, hey, that's my client. You know, he's got a lawyer. I've been out downstairs for an hour and a half waiting to get up. He doesn't want to speak to you guys. They said when they were walking out, he already made a statement.
Two dozen people interviewed by The Guardian confirmed that they were not allowed to make phone calls to relatives or lawyers while being held at home in Square.
Charged with crimes or recently arrested to have a lawyer present, because if they don't, a lot of times they're going to confess to crimes they didn't commit. Police have told them, you can't get a lawyer, you're not entitled to a lawyer, and they believe it.
I think that Home and Square is different than every other police installation in the city, and I think it's a bit disingenuous to somehow say that there is business as usual going on there, because the business going on there is like nothing else in the city.
You know, I think other lawyers are afraid to talk about Home and Square. I think they're afraid that the police might retaliate against them. If anything, they should be trying to put a stop to this so we don't go through this anymore. If this can happen to someone, it can happen to anyone.
So, I mean, that seems legit. I mean, you have to have secret prisons if you're going to have freedom.
And I think it sucks. It's really spot on. I think it's brilliant analysis on my part. You're talking about a place where they have so many quote unquote government controls to try to assure that we don't hurt ourselves in Chicago. And yet it's I don't know if I want to call it Fallujah, but it's kind of like Fallujah. And they've got, you know, the government just has to do what it's got to do to try to, you know, protect us from killing ourselves. So, I mean, what I can't fathom is, you know, we have this mythology that America is the land of the free and liberty, and yet this report has been out. How long has this report been out? The Guardian did this when?
It's been better than 6 months.
Better than 6 months, and that thing still exists. And people have not risen up and said, this is nuts. This is insane. We have to shut this down and shut this down immediately. It hasn't happened. It's kind of like we've just become comfortable in our cages. What do you think, Cal? Are we comfortable in our cages?
Oh, well, there's a lot of areas in that story to examine.
Yeah, there are. I know.
And right now, we're kind of examining the effects of those actions that were committed. There's an area in which, I believe, according to the story, that the son was attacked his mother, right? That's what led to all this. Is that correct?
No,
they're two separate stories. But I'm what I was trying to do here is make the link that the videos that were released by the Chicago PD and Mayor Rahm Emanuel are to distract from the other things that are going on.
Yeah, they're just covering their asses. You know, again, every once in a while they're gonna have to throw one of their own under the bus, right?
Yeah, what happened in the prison, as horrible as it was, pales in comparison to Holman Square.
Right. All right. I believe I remember reading mentions of rape going on, forced sodomy, or, you know, forcible. It's penetration, still rape. Now, the first story I recall hearing, one of the persons who got thrown into this cage was an individual who attacked his mother, right? Assault, as the story was mentioning. I think that's an area kind of still worth examining, because that would be the result of bad parenting. That would be the result of the mother creating this child and having that kind of reaction in this world to attack his own mother. There's a lot of people who sometimes think that, for example, children or people who do violent acts has come out of nowhere. You know, this is a nature versus nurture thing, that this is a versus like the Frankenstein mythology. You know, it's innate. You know, he had body parts of a lot of violent people, so obviously he's going to commit violent acts. But when you look down to it and further look and examine, you'll find that this stuff is learned. I would highly suspect that the son that attacked his mother was, you know, either at a lack of parenting or a lot of abuse occurring in his own life as well, caused by the mother, or allowed to happen, of course, by the guardian who's supposed to protect him. For example, you have like places like Charles Manson, whose mother always who neglected him and always teased him that he was going to be sold off, right? You have another era that it's kind of still kind of recent and new. You have Jeffrey Dahmer. A lot of people say, well, here's an example of somebody who did not grow up in an abusive household. You know, reverse the violence. You have this interviews with the parents there as well. And the parents are like, yeah, they look very novel parents. They look very, you know, they're your typical parents that would be kind and considerate of children. But of course, when it is further revealed in the detail of the transcripts, the parents spanked, assaulted him repeatedly many, many, many times throughout his childhood. But of course, in the media and the world today, that's not equated to assault, right? So a lot of people sometimes say, well, Jeffrey Dahmer is an example of like this coming out of nowhere, this kind of serial killerness coming out of nowhere, this violent reaction coming out of nowhere. No, this is a result of shitty parenting, of violent parenting, of childhood abuse, right? I think that is an area kind of worth examining. We're gonna look why.
So you say violent parenting, crappy parenting, and I think that I would argue with you that it's more systematic of an institutionalized way of behaving. The parents are doing what they know to do. How we deal with correction in general is something that, you know, we were taught, and And honestly, I don't know if somebody could scientifically show the number of people who, unless they come to some extraordinary moment in their life, suddenly decide to be self-aware and to explore the actual standards that they're living out. It's just not a high percentage. So the parents are just carrying forth with what they've learned. Now, if you're talking about people who are more self-aware and they have an understanding of what liberty is, I think you have a better case. But what you're really talking about here is an absolutely systematic cultural conditioning.
I agree with that. I'm not saying go out there and immediately disown everyone or anything like that. What I'm saying is, first, if you want to recognize what is the problem, you have to have an honest conversation about what caused that problem. Right? Have an honest conversation with your parents. Why did you do that? Why did that occur? Why did you slap me? Because I asked questions. And why was your answers always because I said so, because I'm a title, because I'm your parent. Titles, right? You're forcing me to obey authority now. You're telling me never to question authority, right? The first government and state that children ever encounter are their parents before they're released upon the world. But of course, like you're mentioning earlier, this is learned, right? If you want to break the cycle, yeah, that's where it starts. But you have to question and figure out where it comes from. And that's where it comes from. Why did this kid attack his mother? I would have greatly put all my money on the mother herself, lack of parenting, or the mother is beating the crap out of this kid, right? You look at genital mutilation, right? For circumcision, another vile action done to male children in this country, mutilating them, causes a lot of trauma in that child growing up. There's a lot of areas in which that's kind of neglected and trying to understand where this violence is coming from.
Yeah, it's a whole can of worms. I mean, but
all we're dealing now is just the effects of that, right? You know, the effects of this guy hitting his mother or assaulting her is like, oh, well, you know, that was her son. Why would he do that unless it was not learned? She's in charge. She's the guardian of this child to protect him from this world.
And when I say, when I'm talking about the institutionalized violence, coercion, I'm not talking about parents who are just wailing on their kids. That's another story. But listen, we are actually going to shift gears here. We have to have you on. What we have to do is we need to create a 12-hour show, and we need to have you on because there's a lot of stuff here. I mean, just really. I understand. When I was listening to the clips, I was like, oh, my gosh. There is so much. That's like, wow. You know, it's hard to which evil do I target first?
I agree with Genmo.
What I'd like to do now is, because we're short out of time, we have 9 minutes in this segment, and I'm very much interested in you meeting someone. And I think you know who he is.
Great. Would you like to meet Rick Sanchez?
So what I want to know? Oh yeah. I like. I mean, no. I'm. You know, America and the flag. And I just want to talk. You know, so now what we're gonna do is, you're. You know, Niz, who are you? I'm Frank the flag. Who are you?
That's right. I'm Larry the Liberal.
So Larry the Liberal, Frank the flag. We're walking. You know, down the street. We're best of buds, and we don't really – we've never talked about politics, so I'm about ready to get a rude surprise, and so are you. So go ahead, Cal. You come up and just do your thing.
All right. Well, normally I wouldn't be coming up. I would be there.
So we come over and talk to you?
No. My sign would say that I have with me. Right, you're coming to me because my sign says, ask me how government is immoral.
Oh, right? That's great. Dude, what's up with your sign?
It's great, great. So are you curious to know how government is immoral?
Yeah. Well,
right. Well government isn't immoral. There's a social contract. I mean, government is good. It helps
people.
What
are you saying?
Sure. Yeah. And we'll get all to that. So the first thing I want to ask, you know, before we go to an in-depth conversation, I'm going to ask you three simple questions, right? Three simple questions of you, and then discuss how government is immoral. Show you how government is immoral.
All right,
and then I'm going to ask you if you have any comments or questions about that. Sounds good.
I'm down with this.
Is your friend down with that too?
Are you down with that?
That's right.
Larry. What's your name again? I know we've
Larry
been
Larry the Liberal.
Friends.
We're best friends.
Larry,
come on, Frank.
Always
How long
Larry.
Have we known each other?
Larry and Frank. All right. All right, great, great. Thank you for your time. All right, so first question I'm going to ask Larry. Both of you, okay? In your day-to-day lives, do you use violence to solve your personal problems?
Well, sometimes. I mean...
Go ahead. I mean, but the question isn't, have you ever? The question is, in your day-to-day life, right? Unless it's to define violence, right? Violence will be defined as placing a person in an involuntary position without their consent or choice, i.e. rape, murder, theft, and assault, all violation of self-ownership. Would you therefore say, in your day-to-day life, you violate consents of others? Would you, do you rape, murder, steal, and hurt other people?
Well, I can't speak for Larry, but not me.
Now, well, okay, great. And you, Larry?
I'm Larry the Liberal, so I mean if I
I don't know what that means. I just know you as
verbal assault, does that count? Because if it's verbal assault, then I'm not against calling someone, you know, a racist or a bigot or a homophobe or an Islamophobe just so that I can get my way or prove my point or try to sway them to my line of thinking.
Does that fall under rape, murder, theft, and assault?
Could it be verbal assault? I mean, sometimes
verbal assault. Those are sound waves, right? Those are just vibrations in the air, right?
Okay, well, then I guess I don't.
Okay, all right, perfect then. All right,
have you raped anybody today? I just need to know. I need to know this. We're best friends. You're like all over my Facebook page. I need to know.
Right, that's something that you kind of have to know.
Yes, it would be a thing to know.
All right.
Do it live.
Second question, with the exception of self-defense of yourself and others, would you consider it then wrong and immoral to initiate force?
I'm not sure.
All right, so for the difference would be like areas of people someone who wants to rape wants to initiate that force to violate that person's consent. Someone who wants to steal wants to initiate that force by robbing you of that property. The difference between force and aggression would be like areas of boxing, right? So let's separate the two. One is an act of violence that violates consent. The other is an outlet of aggression, like boxing, right? Nothing below the waist, no ear-biting Mike Tyson, and then we can box. But at least that's consensual. They agree to the rules and consequences, right? So the areas outside of self-defense, would you consider it wrong and immoral to initiate force?
What if I'm clowning with someone and I'm you know,
that's consensual.
Snowballing.
That is consensual. No,
they haven't consented to getting hit in the face with a snowball.
No. It's the same thing. Like if you go to a mosh pit for example, right? The underlying rules there before you go in is like people will be bumping shoulders.
But I haven't agreed to it. I haven't. I mean,
we haven't like, agreed to know, it. Then that
I did this to Larry last year. Larry was walking out. I was like the first snow, and I nailed him right between the eyes with a snowball. It was all in good fun though.
Good fun on your part, Larry. How did you feel about that?
It wasn't so much fun.
He cried.
So, Larry, let me ask you then: what are you doing being friends with someone who's being involved in an abusive relationship, Larry?
I think I may be codependent.
You think I might be codependent? I mean, you recognize then if this person can easily throw a snowball and has never had a history, a pattern before that of having that kind of just and fun, then maybe perhaps this person continues to kind of violate your consent and kind of maybe use you as maybe sometimes as an emotional punching bag.
Well, he just needs to man up, stop being a girl, and just deal with
it. No. This is regardless. I mean, Larry, if you were married, right, if you had a relationship, you wouldn't put up with that kind of relationship, would you?
Oh, wait. Are you telling Larry to...
I'm not talking about you. I'm talking to Larry right now. Larry.
No, but are you telling Larry to do divorce?
An abusive relationship with someone who will continue to hurt you and violate your consent. What are you doing calling this person friend then?
That's cold, man.
Well,
that's cold.
Well, he's always just been my friend.
Yeah. I think
maybe Larry, we have Liberty Hangouts. I think maybe, I don't know, consider showing up. I mean, I wouldn't want to be friends with someone who continues to hurt me. Purposefully, right? I'm talking to Larry right now. I wouldn't be friends with somebody who's always being an asshole to me and being a jerk to me, right? That's not a friend. That's not how you define a friend, right? When you go to a restaurant and the restaurant says, hey, how can we make this experience better for you next time, right? And they're trying to improve the situation, relationship you have with Frank. It always seems to worsen, doesn't it, Larry?
Well, maybe he's doing it for my own good. I mean,
if he's on good, then he talked to you. He wouldn't hurt you.
I'm training him to avoid snowballs. It's what I do.
Larry's not interested in what you're trying to do and hurt him. It hurts him. maybe perhaps you guys have this conversation and trying to further explore that. If you call each other friends and that is a genuine thing, maybe Larry has always been saying that because you've been his only friend, quote, for quite a long time.
He's codependent on me is what I think.
Well, I mean, that just means that he needs to find better friends. And there's nothing wrong. It's like the same thing as someone who's involved in an abusive relationship and he or she gets beat up all the time and they're kind of codependent. You kind of have to divorce that. And a real friend will tell you to let go of that connection. It's not worth it, right? Involve yourself with someone who does value you as a human being. It's not out there to hurt you or be a jerk to you or be an asshole to you.
So I'm going to go out of character briefly here. So when you're having this real conversation with someone, this is – you would actually do this. You would, like, if you – met up with these two dudes, and one of them was clearly.
It never gets this far.
If they're like that, they probably have shut you down by now.
Right, they'd be done. Right, and this is how I respond. Right. Huh. Obviously, we're not going to get past these questions. You are already admitting that you have no problem violating consent. I think that is very important to show. And having something now on camera to record this individual has no problem being an asshole and jerks to people who takes advantage of them, who abuses them. I think that's kind of very important for the community to see who the would-be assholes are.
I don't like Frank the Flag. That guy's total.
Sounds like
total. Well, dick. Listen, we're gonna skip the break and we're gonna keep going here.
All right. So let's get the break. Let me go back in time and change my answer there
because I want you to be. No, I don't rape anyone. You know, I'm right. Yeah, I don't do that.
All right,
I'm not against using force if it's for someone else's own good. I mean, if I'm doing something, if I have to do that to protect you.
That was the second question, with the exception of self-defense.
Well, right? I'm not saying not just self-defense. I mean, if let's say that, you know, you want to do something, you're going to do drugs. Drugs are bad, okay? Well, I don't want you to do drugs, so. Well, I'm Larry the Liberal, and I say
drinking alcohol.
I'm Larry the Liberal, and I say that drugs are bad, except for the ones that the government says are good. So, I think that, you know, alcohol is okay because it's legal. Caffeine is okay because it's legal.
Is alcohol a drug?
It is, but it's a good drug. It's legal. Okay.
I mean, it doesn't matter. So at some point in time, it was illegal through prohibition, right? And all of a sudden, by the magical words of government, it was made legal and therefore good. In the past, it was considered evil. By a wave of some magical piece of papers, it became good, right? So at some point in the past, it was evil, right? So you will have to vehemently be against people drinking alcohol if you want to be consistent.
But
right?
But what about rule of law? If we don't have rule of law, there's...
I mean, we can have rules. We can have law. I mean, show me factual evidence of your contractual relationship with these laws.
With the government? The Constitution. It's in the Constitution.
Versus signature. Your signature's on there? Show it to me.
Yeah, I was born into it, you know? It's where? Like America.
No, social contract.
I'm actually grateful for what my country has done.
Actually, simple question. Show me factual evidence of your contractual relationship with government. If you're saying the Constitution, show me your signature on that document.
I don't need that signature. I've enjoyed the benefit of government.
It's implied. The social contract is implied.
It's implied that you have no factual evidence. Did you also know that it's implied, well, not implied, factually evidence-wise, that no one signed the Constitution? No one signed it.
What do you mean? There's we got John Hancock. He signed it.
The only signatures you find are in witnesses whereof. Witnesses.
Just so everybody knows, I am playing character. I'm not that stupid.
Frank, can you stop that? What that means is notarizer. When you go to a notarizer, we don't have a document notarizer. The job of a notarizer is to authenticate that this is a legitimate, authentic document. So they sign with their name and witness whereof. They don't sign, of course, in signatures. So I'm held to the terms and responsibilities outlined in this document, right?
Yeah.
But, so when you look at the Constitution, that is exactly where the signatures lie. They do not.
You know, I believe in the Constitution.
It's an outdated document.
Feelings is not a factual evidence.
But listen. Give me a place to sign, and I'll sign it.
Well, you can show me real contracts that you have with like Netflix, AT&T.
I'm willing to go down to Independence Hall in Atlanta. Is it Atlanta? And I'm willing to go to Independence Hall and I'm willing to sign that document to say, yes, I am in it.
All right. So but you would say that a contract that you sign, right, with you and the party people who are there with you, that contract only obliges itself, is only held responsible to only those people who sign it.
Right? So I could let the president can sign, like, Paul, you're in.
Then the contract only applies to the president and whoever signs it. If I got with my friends and wrote out a loan, right, and said, well, the person who's going to pay for it will be you, but I outnumber you, I have several of my friends, you know, you never gave me power of attorney to give me that consent. You would say, yeah, that contract is null and not valid. Would you not?
I mean, this is nuts. If I don't follow the Constitution, if I don't follow the law, you know, I'm gonna end up getting arrested. And I'm going to end up getting in jail. And if everybody acted like that, we would have chaos in this country. Do you want chaos? Have chaos.
All right, so let's examine chaos, right? So would you not say, therefore, that the millions and millions of people suffering in rape cages right now, for a majority of them for victims?
Rape cages?
What does that mean? Yeah, it means that the majority of people in this country, in terms of gender and whatnot, that is males that are raped the most when you throw them into this container of cages with the most vile and vicious. Would you say that that is order? Do you say that is peace? Peace.
Listen, if they obey the law, then they don't go to jail. If they don't obey the law, they go to jail. That's just the way it is. If you don't have anything to hide,
then
you got nothing to be afraid of.
Let me ask you then, do you have any factual evidence that your law applies to me?
I do. If you break the law, you get arrested.
That's not a factual evidence. Do you have factual evidence to show that the law, that the jurisdiction of your law applies to me, much less anyone else?
I don't need facts. See, I live in the world of reality where your intellectual, highbrow facts, they exist.
So you have no facts or evidence. You have just feelings.
I exist where the rubber meets the road, where you get things done. The sweat of my brow, all that stuff. You know, I work at Walmart. When I'm working at Walmart, I don't need a freaking contract to tell me that I got to do good at my job or I'm going to get fired.
That is in your contract when you sign up and work for Walmart. If you're not good at your job, if you steal from them, if you violate the terms of the agreements, they will fire you. You sign that. That is factual. That's factual evidence of explicit consent of that. Wrong. You just show me something that which you have already done. That is a real contract you could show me. You could show me your contract with the employer and the employee, a negotiations that you have. That is something real. That is something you give explicit consent. Walmart did not point a gun at you to force you under those terms. You sought them out, right? Show me.
Larry, you gotta help me out here. This dude is too smart for me.
Show me your contract with government. I'm waiting.
You know what? You could dazzle me with your little Princeton.
No. Show it to me.
Princeton 25 cent words. You know.
Show it to me,
Larry. Come on, man.
Show me the money. Show me the contract.
Come on, Larry. You're smart. Put him in his place. Come on, Larry.
So without government, what you're saying is that there shouldn't be a government.
We're not even going there. We're still stuck in question number two. Would you consider it wrong and immoral to initiate force outside areas of self-defense?
No, that's not immoral because some people just need to be forced to do things for their own good.
Right. I mean, wants them to
give
do.
An example.
Baker's baking cakes for gay people and like.
Are you against, are you for discrimination? I mean, don't get me wrong, man. I don't believe that gays should even be married.
You're a bigot.
Self-defense of yourself? You're saying that these people, you've never met, you've taken a gay for an attack on you?
This country's going to go to hell.
Let's start right there. So you're saying it's okay to violate someone's consent because of their preferences.
If you don't like the culture,
you're saying it's okay to violate someone's consent, right? Is that what you are? Is that your position?
If you don't like the culture, you can leave.
Because you're going to hurt. Listen,
Why should I leave? How about the murderers and thieves leave, right? How about those people leave? Civilization belongs to the civilized, not to the would-be murderers and thieves. How about you get the fuck out of here? How about you leave the city?
I think that the civilization belongs to the people who act in the right way and have the right standards.
Your solution is to run away if you don't like it. That's a very cowardly.
I think it's for the good people.
What does that mean?
It's for people that know right from wrong.
Right from wrong? You just told me you have no problem violating someone's consent because they have a different opinion from you.
Well, you know, I mean, like gays, you know, getting married.
So you should get married.
That's just wrong.
No, this is great. No, on camera, please tell me how much you hate the gays.
How much you hate other people. Oh, that's good.
Tell me how much you think about where they put their penises in. Tell me how much you think about their cocks. Tell me how often.
Have you ever, slipping on a character slightly, have you ever going down that road, and what's that been like?
I only had that happen once with a communist. Go figure.
Wow, a communist.
That's it. So that the only time I've ever had an interruption like that in trying to differentiate. That's only because a communist views everything as violence without a proper definition. So they'll view that you protecting your property is violence, but they have no separation from the difference from the initiation of force and from the defense from that initiation. For them, love is rape and rape is lovemaking. And the conversation didn't get anywhere past the second question or the first question.
So just for the sake of expediency, I know we're probably not actually acting like actual street people. We're doing our best, you know. We're trying to be standoffish.
But that's the thing. We cannot discuss how the government is immoral until we get through these three questions, right?
So let's get to number three.
If there's difficulty getting there, it is very revealing already that your moral position, if it is that difficult, like right now in these conversations, that you have no problem violating someone's consent. And I think it's a great thing to have a camera when you have this kind of interview, so that way you can show your community who the would-be rapists are, who the would-be Dexter Morgans are.
What I really like about what you do and how you do it is you're kind of making them face who they really are. And I'd be willing to bet that there's a lot of people, I know you're going to find this shocking, that lie to you, that actually really do follow a coercive worldview, that they actually are for forcing folks to act a certain way just because, you know, they've deemed it wrong.
Well, that's a generalization which can be deemed as a fallacy if made as an argument. So I would say what you're doing now is what government says. And a lot of their polls, for example, sometimes they'll say, well, look at this poll here versus males and females. Males generally say, let's legalize cannabis. Females say, let's keep it illegal. So now you can create this kind of false lying information to pass that females are less inclined for liberty and males are, right? But you cannot show me your factual evidence, any kind of study that you've actually gone out there and showed me that you've gone and talked to them about option C. How about none of the above? Right. So I would say that what you're doing now is just projecting the whole Hobbesian idea that has been deeply ingrained in many of these public indoctrination camps, that everyone's evil, that everyone's this is a secret Dexter Morgan character.
Well, no, I don't mean that everyone's evil. I mean that most people.
It doesn't matter once it's recorded, though. Once it's on camera, you've already shown that this is your position. And if you show otherwise in your actions that you're against that, then that's something else. Right. You've just showed on camera that you believe this is wrong and immoral. This is recorded, recorded evidence for the world to see, right? So even if you are lying, that is a good thing too. It shows that even the worst of characters will have to lie to live in a free society, have to restrain themselves and pretend otherwise if they want to live in this society. And this tall grass of statism where there's violence everywhere and the language is all abstract, and which means violence is trade and trade is taxation and going all the way around, yeah, you can hide. Like the would-be murderer that you are. But when it's clear cut, when the question is very objective, do you advocate for consent or not? You put yourself on the spot.
So you've actually answered one of my questions, which I didn't get to, which is, why do you use the camera?
Right.
That totally answers that question.
I've had a conversation with somebody who was trying to troll and who was trying to say, yeah, I would violate consent and all that stuff. And I just put him on the spot and said, well, you know, this is recording right now. I'm going to put this on YouTube. And immediately he stopped. Immediately he changed face. Immediately said, I'm so sorry. That's not really meant. You know, I was just trying to be facetious. And, you know, some of these ideas just come from my parents. That's where they're coming from. You know, I really didn't mean that. Right.
I never
put that video out there. I still have it. I never put it out there because it seemed genuine that he made a mistake and he didn't mean to go that far, right?
Do you, Cal, ever run into people who, when you're talking about the initiation of force, do you ever run into people who
they want to take that stance. Well, you know, if it's for their own good, like, you know, if it's going to hurt someone else's feelings for me not to initiate force. You know, you have like, you see all the things going on now on college campuses with their safe spaces and microaggressions and all this kind of stuff. And that tends to be more of like a liberal Democrat. I mean, if you're talking about like the two-party dichotomy, the way that the people are divided in their mindsets, that seems to be more prevalent on. Well, I can't even really say that because it goes to both sides. I mean, you have liberal Democrats who want to.
What you're talking about, Niz, when you're talking about safe spaces, and conservatives are rightly not for the whole safe space concept. They see it's a fundamental violation of free speech. Now, I'm not talking about a safe space in your living room, but when you cut out a public area and just declare that this is your safe space, or an open area that everybody has free access to, I should say. When we had atheists that bought signs in somewhere in the South, I can't remember where it was. This is a recent story that says, you know, don't go to church for Christmas. Now, I'm a Christian, but, you know, I don't really care if you have a sign up that says that somebody shouldn't go to church on Christmas. But there are a lot of Christians in the South who are upset at that. And when you listen to how they were talking, they actually sounded just like the social justice warriors. And what they were saying was, they need to take it down. That thing is offensive to me. I don't know why.
Well, I'm talking more force for feelings, where you know, like if you don't want to bake. I keep going back to this bakery thing for some reason, but it's a good example. You don't want to bake my cake, so now I'm gonna go and press charges on you, and you're gonna get arrested. You're gonna get fined. Maybe you're gonna go to jail.
So we got two forms.
That's what I mean. The force for feelings. And do you run across people often who get to that point where they're willing to say that they are, you know, they're willing to initiate force to protect someone else's feelings?
I've never come across that.
And you actually in our conversation, we kind of had it going both ways. You had my character who was willing to coerce gay people to act according to what he wanted to, based on his beliefs.
Right.
And then you had on the other side somebody who wanted to coerce a baker to act according to his beliefs.
That's very rare, though. I've only came across that once, but he was like a 16-year-old kid who said, yeah, you know, you talk shit, I'm going to hurt you, whatever. And I said, well, so the feelings, of, you know, the words of strangers hurt your feelings, have that effect on you. And so, yeah, it hurts. It's like, well, you know, we can't discuss this anymore. You know, I can't have a... I can't pretend to have a civilized conversation with a savage, with someone who have no problem doing that, right?
So if this was a real street thing, you probably would have been done with Larry and...
Well, I'd have to call you out on camera.
And Frank a while ago, right?
Right, right. And then I'll put you up on YouTube to show these are people you know socially ostracized because they have no problem violating your consent. And it's great that we have this on video on camera so everyone can see, right? So, because it's very important. If you want to advocate against that, government does a good job trying to hide that from people. In a free society, your intentions are known. You know, the things that you advocate for are known. And those are the people I want to avoid and not patronize, right? Don't hide in secret. Don't hide behind a closet. Come it out. Tell me who you hate. So that way I have nothing to do with you. And as well, all the people as well. But I rarely, except for that one time, but he was... He's just a kid. It's like maybe 16 years old, so it was no big deal. But that's it. I've never really come across anyone saying, oh, the third question when I ask other people, when they say, yeah, outside of areas of self-defense, it's wrong and immoral to initiate force. But it would be, would you consider it wrong and immoral to violently enforce your ideas onto other people? And people are like, yeah, absolutely. You know, versus having a conversation, having a discussion, what we're doing now, or even arguing, right? If you didn't like what I had to say, you can ignore me, ostracize me, or walk away. But if I came after you and grabbed you by the shoulder and put a gun at you and said, no, you have to follow what I have to, you have to do what I say. Now I'm violently forcing my ideas onto you, right? And everyone, I would say a majority, 95% of the conversation, agreed. Well, the videos that you see online never get that far in the conversation and showing the immorality of the state unless they agree. So every single video, when I skip over the first three questions, because it's like the same questions, they will all agree. So that's over 95% success rate to show the effectiveness and how.
But sometimes you do show the and actually even in the mashup, I'll call it, what the heck, that we did for you, we actually showed those questions.
Right, yeah.
So
yeah,
you
yeah.
do sometimes show the questions.
Sometimes this is a refresher. So sometimes I feel like it's been a month. Here's a refresher of the questions for anyone who's watching.
It seems like what you're doing, which I really love what you're doing. I love how you're doing it, is you are sticking to, I mean, this is the hardcore nap, and you're applying it and walking people through. What I see is what you are showing people is you've accepted a certain standard when it comes to your own personal life. Other than somebody who's insane, I mean, let's be honest, Frank has got some issues.
Sounds like a commie to me.
he's a neocon, which is almost interchangeable with commie, really. But it sounds like, I mean, you take them to a place where they have to come face to face with the reality that they have accepted a governance in their lives that is fundamentally in violation with basic human action. Would that be accurate?
Yes, about. Well, I'll show them that they've been misled, not that they accepted. I show that first you have this more integrity against initiation of force. And then I show them what government is, and then show them that they've been misled. Kind of like earlier we were talking about parents and stuff like that and the information they don't know and the effects of what they're doing to children. Yeah, you know, when I talked to my mother, she didn't know. She's just repeating the cycle of violence. That's what she brought up on, right? Same thing with this information with government. So I show that they've been misled, not that they actually took an active measurement of choice to accept it. Now you have a
prediction. I, for instance, I did spank my daughter. Hadn't spanked her in I don't even know how long, but three times in her life I spanked her. And I absolutely, when I spanked her, I did it in all the ways that, you know, I was told to do the spanking, and not doing it out of anger, making sure I explain exactly why she... I was being what I thought was a good, responsible parent. And there was, I guess you could say, cognitive dissonance. And actually, I would say at that time, I would never think that I would go ahead and spank someone like a friend because they did something that I didn't want them to do. But somehow...
You're not going to spank me, Paul, are you?
Oh, I might do that today.
I just told you for the last time.
He's a bad friend.
Somehow, I had created... And because I had learned, I had created special rules for special situations, and I think that's what you make everybody bring all of the situations under the same set of rules, and that's got to be very upsetting to people when you introduce that to them. It's a fundamental challenge to their identity, of who and what they are. And how they do things. I know for me, even the transition from, I mean, I went through the whole wide gambit. I started off as a liberal when I really didn't care that much about politics, and liberal just meant that I liked poor people. And then I became a conservative because, you know, protect the country and all that stuff. All of those transitions were all painful, and they all took years to accomplish because it was like, you know, truth is not as important as identity to most people. Until you get to the point where the truth just gets so much in your head that you can no longer live in the identity, then you're willing to pay the price, the death that you have to face. Because every time you change your identity, a significant identity, you go through a death.
Or you could say our evolution, right?
Or whatever you want to call it. But, I mean, you are out there basically, and I love what you do, and I want more people to do it. And, you know, somewhere down the road I might do it myself. So you are really out there, and I understand the style that you use. You have a very calm demeanor about you, which is pretty essential to what you're doing, which is you're not sticking your finger in their eye, certainly not doing it intentionally, But in a lot of ways, you are.
How effective, Cal, would you say? How effective would you say that you believe that your approach is? Knowing that there are a good portion of people who answer the way they do simply because you have a camera on them, and they don't want to be put on the spot and say, yeah, you know, I'm an authoritarian, and I think the government should force people to do what I think they should do, and I think that that's okay. How effective do you think that approach is in having people leave after they've had this interaction with you and have this, you know, a epiphany moment where they say, hey, you know what, maybe I've been looking at the world the wrong way?
After doing this for 4 years, I would say it is the most effective way to introduce dimensions of freedom. The videos that you see are only the recorded ones, the ones who, because I ask them if it's okay to record, right, before I do that. And so those are close to 300 recorded individual interviews. Outside of that, there are a great many and many other people who didn't feel comfortable, but I still have to continue to have those conversations. So I would say up to this point, I've had over 1,000 conversations, and they all go the same way. So a majority of them, over 2/3 of them, not recorded, and they still fall the same way. They still answer the same way, not even being put on the spotlight. They agree the initiation of force is wrong. They agree with the argument against the state. How far they go, that goes, it's hopefully, you know, it's a way to see if we meet up again. And so in Richmond, we have monthly gatherings. Now we have weekly meetings to help bring that interest in. Now we have over 100 anarchists here in Richmond, just growing after a short, over 3 years now, 4 years.
So you're seeing that Liberty RVA is growing, it's expanding. The more interactions that you see, the more people are coming to your meetings.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. So I find a measure of success in parents talking to them, and then they stop hitting their kids. But, you know, that's the information they were giving. That's the same information towards, like, someone who once advocated against minimum wage. They've never been received real good, accurate, honest information. And then once you receive that information, then not so much you can judge, but then you can decide for yourself what position do you have now that you've been presented option C, none of the above. Throughout your life, you're never presented that. Throughout your life, you're always presented option A, statism, or option B, statism. You're never given C,
none above. Well, option A, statism, that coerces these values and these behaviors, and option B, statism, that coerces these values and these behaviors. Right. And maybe you're lucky and you like the ones of option B, statism, but it's still the same thing.
Right. So I find a great measure of success. It's the most effective way to introduce it. And that's why I record it, to show otherwise, to show the success of, I guess, the rhetoric that I created. And that took months and months to put together. Just talking to some of my best friends here in Richmond to go through all their questions and then finally figure out a way that I could put them all in a concise algorithm that comes out to a great, successful discussion, conversation.
Cool.
So because I find otherwise, if you don't set it up, it's kind of like if you're going to box, let's agree with the rules. You set up the argument, right? You set up the rules and then you box. Same thing with arguing, right? Before we argue, let's set up the rules and the definitions and terms, and then we can argue, and then we can have a discussion. If we're going to have a discussion, then it's only to get to a better place, right? Not to throw more wood in the fire. And I found if you don't set it up, I mean, you could do it without setting it up over time when you become good at it, but otherwise, if you don't, in general, yeah, you'll come across all these crazy, wild, left field, moving the goalpost, Frank and Larry arguments, and it'll never get anywhere.
Right. Right. So you had made a reference to Hobbes early on. Do you have a belief then that people are inherently good? I don't necessarily share that view that people are inherently good. I kind of have a view that people aren't inherently good. People are inherently practical. At the end of the day, people really do want to get by with the least amount of cost to themselves. And coercion, violence, is always a heavy cost. Would you accept that nuance, or are you absolutely rigid on, no, all people are good?
No one's anything until I have that conversation. And with the videos that I've recorded in the interviews, I've shown a substantial amount of factual evidence to show majority of people are good. When I press them for asking them what their moral positions are and what they consider to be wrong and immoral, they agree that it's wrong and immoral to violate that consent. a majority, a substantial majority of people agree with that. So so that's my test and evidence to go against Hobbes. And Hobbes himself was abandoned as a kid.
And I'm no Hobbesian, by the way.
And Hobbes himself was abandoned as a kid. He had no father. He grew up in a life of lack of parenting and violent upbringing. So of course he's going to project his child onto the rest of the world that it's evil and crude. So I would say that, you know, don't, you know, if you feel like someone's good or evil, it's, you know, go out there and ask them these moral questions, right?
I don't know if I would say good or evil. I would say practical or impractical.
The practical and impractical errors are errors in which the government has disguised the language and pushed forward language like doublespeak. So what they have learned from government is doublespeak. So their ethics and considering and trying to figure out what is good and bad, government has messed that up a lot for many of them. They've made it in a way so they can combine abstract and concrete concepts together. So that's why they view sometimes, without having this conversation, that the social contract must be a real contract, right? The language has been meddled. And that's how you want to control people. You control them by the words that they use. So it's
okay. We got the music in here. We're winding down on time. So why don't you just let people know where they can find you at, and we'll
have all your links in our show notes.
No, this has been so much fun, guys. So you can find a lot of the information really just going to liberaterva.com. RVA stands for Richmond, Virginia. That's the same screen name you'll find for YouTube. You'll find my other channel, Renegade Boy Scout, on there as well.
We'll definitely want to have you back on because there's a lot of meat to discuss there. I'm really interested in talking to you about standards and a lot more about your community. Very, very interested in your community. Do you post a lot of information about how your community is growing? And
if you want to just find me on Facebook, I'll add you to the Liberate RVA group. A lot of consistent good people that are vetting people. You know, that's how you want to make sure you never get hurt. You know, you vet your community. So come and find me.
Very, very cool. Well, thank you so much for being on the show. It's probably been the best show in the history of podcasting. And I say that humbly. So, I mean, right, Niz?
That's right, without a doubt.
So next week, Niz, tell me what we're doing next week real quick. Do we have time to say what we're doing next week?
Yes, we're trying to put together a great show for everyone next week. We're going to have we're trying to get two guests on to have a debate on jury nullification. So make sure you tune in for that. Since we're running down on time, I'm going to cut this short. Make sure you tune in next week, Friday, 8 p.m. Eastern, Disassociation Nation. Have a great weekend.
Left behind, dollar signs rule. But what about the fool who falls victim to the material world?